For those that have dialed in live to the session as well, feel free to put in your questions via Slido. We'll make sure we cover them throughout our 35 minutes of chatting together. But I'm Graham O'Brien, I'm from the ASX. I've been at the ASX 20 years, I think industry 25, and pretty much that whole time I've known Liz as well. Joining us from Citi is really the only issuer of our warrants market, which we're going to touch on in quite a lot of detail when we start thinking about using leverage effectively, because we really need to have a good understanding of the risks involved when you're getting into leverage in the marketplace. It isn't all smooth sailing when it comes to some products with leverage. So that's really what we're going to be focusing on in our session. So the very first question that I guess I'd like to ask, and I know you've answered this one for me many a times, Liz, is really, what is leverage? Many of you, this might be the first experience that you've heard of leverage, but what do you see leverage as?
Yeah, we do love the very, you know, those acronyms and complicating sounding words in finance. So how I like to compare leverage, when I get asked a lot about what we do, is I try to make it quite simple and bring it back down to basics. And what leverage simply is it's borrowing. And we're all quite familiar with borrowing to invest. Most of us here have probably at some point in time borrowed to buy our first property, and investment properties. What we're going to talk about mainly today is how to use this concept of borrowing in particular to invest in things like shares and ETFs and securities on the exchange. And, you know, some of the risks and pitfalls and things to be aware of when you do look at a borrowing strategy.
Yeah, I think so. And it's all about risk when it comes to leverage. Everyone thinks about the reward first, but we really need to have a key concentration on that risk. And I think one of the easiest ways to show it is via an illustration. And on the slide that you can see on the screen, we're just comparing Commonwealth Bank shares. So let's say we go out and buy 500 Commonwealth Bank shares at $88 versus using leverage to get exposure to those same 500 Commonwealth Bank shares that might only cost you something like $12. If Commonwealth Bank share price was to increase, so let's say it goes up from $88 to $93, we would have made $2,500 on our share portfolio for the initial $44,000 outlay. However, if we use leverage, it might have only cost us $6,000 to get that exposure to Commonwealth Bank shares, but we've still profited $2,500 from that transaction. So why people are using leverage is to give them that better percentage return in their outcome. So only 5.7% return that we saw with shares, but you've almost got 42% of return when it comes to leverage. That's normally what people focus on, but we also need to consider the risk, as Liz mentioned. What if Commonwealth Bank shares actually fell from 88 down to 83? You would have lost $2,500 on your shares, also lost $2,500 on our leveraged exposure, but from a percentage return perspective, you almost lost half of what you outlaid when it comes to that leveraged instrument. And where we need to be careful is there are leveraged instruments where we can lose more than what we even started with. So we need to have a really clear understanding is what is our risk when we're getting involved with leverage. So if I think about it, there's a whole range of different types of leverage, whether it's CFDs, margin lending, options, instalment warrants and minis that I know Citi list. But that very first point, I think it's important that we touch on it for a little bit when we think about, is the loss limited to the initial outlay? And we know that with a CFD or a margin loan, you can actually lose multiples of your initial outlay. We know with a margin loan, generally it's a 30% deposit to get exposure to that share. If that stock falls by more than 30%, and we've seen some tech stocks of late that can happen, you're going to have to stump up with a margin call on those instruments. Things like options, instalments, and minis, the most you can lose when you're buying those instruments is what you outlay. So could you touch on how that actually works from an instalment or a mini perspective? How is it that investors, when they're looking for leverage, the most they can lose is just what they outlay?
Yeah, so let's use that Commonwealth Bank as an example. A lot of people think leverage is all about magnifying my risk. And some people absolutely do use leverage to magnify their risk, but sometimes you can also use it to control your risk. And what we mean by that is when Graham ran through that Commonwealth Bank example, instead of spending $45,000, $50,000 to buy and get exposure to that 500 Commonwealth Bank shares and getting dividends on those 500 Commonwealth Bank shares, In that example, you spent $6,000. So you're getting the same exposure, but you're putting less outlay. You don't have to go, oh, leverage. Instead of putting 6,000 versus 50,000, I'm going to buy five times as much or 10 times as much. Some people obviously do use that strategy, some traders, but you don't always have to use that strategy. You can always use strategy also to try and manage your risk by putting a smaller outlay. And if you put a smaller outlay, and that's the maximum you can lose, in some instances, that's going to help you manage that risk. So that's that first thing that Graham's touching on, limited recourse. So using CommBank as an example, if you were to buy a CommBank share, if it falls $10, you've obviously lost $10. If it goes up $10, you also gain $10. On limited recourse loans, if you buy CommBank and you outlay $5 or $10 on the CommBank instalment, let's use $10 as an example. If CommBank falls $10, you're going to lose $10. But if CommBank falls $15, you can only lose that maximum of that $10. So that's one of the ways to kind of manage your risk using leverage. And you know, you'll see different types of loans out there that you can choose from. There's not only one type. You've got to work out what's suitable. But one of the things to look at is it limited recourse, meaning you can only lose what you outlay. And it's because of this feature, limited recourse, that this type of borrowing, instalments, minis, is allowable in your self-managed super funds. We see around 70% of our holders holding instalment warrants on especially the banking stocks. 70% of that is in self-managed super fund money.
Yeah, it's great. And we have some very important points also on this slide, and it's more about ease of use when I think of it from that perspective. Is many of you might be used to trading shares in the share market. Depending on the instrument that you're using, will that type of leverage that they're actually getting access to actually move the same way as you expect the shares? And I know with instalments and minis, they'll move dollar for dollar, cent for cent with the way that the underlying shares move. However, with products like options, they can provide you leverage, provide you with that limited recourse, but you need a little bit of extra education because they don't necessarily move dollar for dollar, cent for cent. And it's probably something you definitely want to get more educated about. Counterparty protection, trading on exchange with your brokers gives you access to national guarantee funds and the like. I know one of the main things, and you touched on self-managed super, a lot of people like getting leveraged access to dividends. And just because I'm only outlaying, say, $6,000 on Commonwealth Bank shares, doesn't mean I only get a smaller proportion of those dividends. I actually get full access to those dividends. You want to touch on that for a moment, and that's really important for self-managed super funds, I think, as well.
Yeah, so let's use Commonwealth Bank as an example. So Commonwealth Bank is about $90, and if you were to buy 100 shares, that's $9,000, or you might decide to go 50% leverage and outlay approximately half, so $5,000 and borrow approximately $4,000. Now, it is a loan product, but when you buy that 100 Commonwealth Bank instalments, what's actually happening behind the scenes? That moment you put that trade through your broker, such as, you know, Bell Direct or NAB, when you buy that 100 Commonwealth Bank instalments, an instant later, Citi is buying 100 Commonwealth Bank shares, and we put that in a bear trust because you're the beneficial owner of that bear trust. Now, there's 100 Commonwealth Bank shares now sitting in that bear trust. So when CommBank pays that dividend, we pass those dividends through. We can either pass it to you directly or we can use it to pay down the loan. But there's different features with different types of instalments. It's up to you to pick what style suits you. And because you're also the beneficial owner of those 100 Commonwealth Bank shares, the franking credits get passed through. So end of the financial year, you will get a tax statement giving you, you know, passing through those dividends and franking credits. But essentially for that half, that outlay of $5,000 versus the $9,000, you get the same dividends and franking credits. Now, of course, you've also got to pay interest because this is a loan product. So you're paying interest on approximately half, but so $5,000, but you're getting dividends on the full amount. So depending on the stock that you pick, some are going to be positively geared, Some are going to be neutrally geared, some are going to be negatively geared, just like when you buy an investment property. Depends on, you know, how high the yield is on the stock versus the interest on the loan.
You touched on interest just for a moment. So obviously, all of these instruments are effectively a borrowing money to invest, whether it's in anyone, options, CFDs, margin loans, instalments. What's that interest to expect, and how is that calculated and built into the product?
So similar to if you were to go to bank to buy an investment property, there's different loans. You know, you might decide you want to be variable, you want to be fixed on your investment property loan. We've got different features within our instalment warrants product. We have ones where the interest is capitalised daily to the loan. We have ones where it's prepaid. We have the feature where you might want to have the dividends paid directly to you, and some where the dividends are used to pay down the loan. The best thing to do is if you are thinking about using this strategy, for example, in your self-managed super fund or trying to build that portfolio down the track, we've got 4,000 warrants. We've got many different styles. The best thing is always we say, call the desk. We have people call the desk and go, I'm looking for something that's only, you know, 40% geared. I want the dividends to pay down the loan over time, and I want to make sure I get the franking credits, and we can guide you to the type of warrant that has those features that you're looking for.
I think we're going to touch on in the strategy piece, but I know with dividends, you noted that you get full access to dividends. Are we going to touch on a strategy that you see your clients using to try and harness more dividends out in the marketplace, or do you want to do that later or now?
We can do that now. So obviously, the different types of investors, you know, we see people who are very short-term, day trading or trading for 1 or 2 weeks. And then we've got the other type of investor who is really looking to build their portfolio over time. They buy maybe a handful of blue chip shares or ETFs, and it's very much a set and forget strategy. And then in between, we've got investors who might have 80% of their shareholding in blue chip shares and then, you know, have about 20% for gearing, etc. One strategy we see that's fairly often, and you'll see that in a slide later, is the popularity of people buying instalments for dividends. So do many of you here hold bank shares? So we know bank shares traditionally, and even now mining companies, pay very high dividends. Now the banks, as you know, they tend to pay dividends twice a year. There's Westpac, ANZ and NAB paying at one time, and then Commonwealth Bank, Woolworths, Telstra at another point in time. So a strategy we do see is instead of holding Westpac for the full 12 months and collecting two dividends, we see people kind of harvest dividend and hold it for that 2-3 month period and switching that four times a year to try and pick up those four sets of dividends in a year.
Yeah, definitely a very popular strategy. When I think about who uses leverage, you touched on it, we've got short-term traders, long-term traders. What would you tend to see? Is it more short-term versus long-term, or more long-term versus short-term over the last year or so?
It's surprising. It is actually quite balanced from what we see. So to share some colour with you on what, you know, it's probably quite close to 50-50. Obviously, the short-term stuff, we see very high turnover because people are only holding that sometimes daily or sometimes a couple of weeks or 2-3 months to kind of harvest that dividend. And then we have the other end, the self-managed super fund, which is much longer term. Now, the longer-term investors tend to want more conservative leverage. So they might go, you know, 30% or 40-50%. And the shorter term traders tend to go for higher leverage. So if you are considering using leverage as a strategy, it is quite important to take into account things like what stock are you actually buying? Using CommBank as an example, we had someone chat to us and they actually took out a loan to buy CommBank when it first, the first public placement, the IPO, 20, 25 years ago, and they took out a loan, and CommBank shares was $2 at that time. And obviously over time, you know, CommBank shares have gone up. So it is very important what stock you select, you know, whether it's a blue chip share or a diversified ETF versus the underlying stock that you're putting leverage on. Just like any other thing, you know, the type of property you might buy, what asset is it? What's the quality of the asset? The second thing to take into account is also the time frame. You know, if you've got a long-term time frame on a blue chip share portfolio, hopefully over time it does grow, and that's another factor that's very important to take into account.
It's interesting you say Commonwealth Bank. I was actually one of those guys that bought it when it listed. It was actually listed as an instalment.
It was, absolutely.
Payment up front. So, and Telstra, for those that were unfortunately getting involved, I think Telstra 1 was okay, but the rest weren't as nice. It's a style that has been around for a long time, not just from investment banks. Companies have used it as well. How do people access it, though? If I'm an investor that wants to access, whether it be an instalment or an option or anything else that's listed on the ASX, how do I go about accessing it?
So if it's a warrant, you would need a warrants agreement form, but you can buy it through your broker. So Bell Direct, NAB, CommSec, Morgans, Bell Potter, etc., through any broker, you will need a one-time warrants agreement form, and thereafter you can, because all our warrants are listed on the ASX, they sit alongside your shares. So they'll sit alongside your BHP and CommBank shares, etc. Obviously with options, you set up an options trading account. With a margin loan, you need to set up a margin loan.
So we're going to touch on some of those usage trends of how customers are using warrants, and then we'll touch on options for a moment or two's time as well. So you've got a long list of all of the warrants that were purchased in calendar year 20. And there's different styles of warrants that people are actually transacting in, and a lot more value in some rather than others. Do you want to walk us through this slide?
Sure, I have to stand up because I'm a bit short-sighted, so I can see it more easily. Now, this is information that was shared with us from the ASX. I thought I'd share it with you today because it gives you a bit of background and a feel for what people who are using leverage are doing in the market. So these were the top 20 warrants that were traded in probably one of the most volatile years last year. Now you'll see that under product style, we categorize them. The ASX categorize different styles of warrants. They're trading warrants, typically high leverage, short term, you can go long or short. And then the ASX categorize other types of warrants as investment style, where it might be more conservatively geared, 30, 40, 50%. You can, and any point in time, if you change your mind, you just pay off the loan and take the shares outright. So you can see the two different styles, firstly, of the type of warrants people use. Now you'll see Fortescue, which is a mining stock, was the most popular last year. That was a little bit atypical last year. Most of the time it's always indexed, but obviously we saw iron ore prices went fairly crazy. Fortescue went to all-time high, and the mini short was the most popular. Now, I haven't really touched on the mini short, but what the mini short does is it's a leverage product for people looking to short the market. Now, you don't always have to leverage to go long. You can leverage to go short. Most of the time, if you were to come to Citi and say, what's more popular, longs or shorts? Our loan book is skewed more to shorts. And the reason for that is not because most people are negative on the market. The reason for that is most people will go long the market through their core portfolio. They'll have their shares, their kind of longer term that they set and forget, through the ETFs and blue chip shares. And from time to time, they might think the market's a little bit toppy, or might this share's gone up too high, I want to hedge it. And they use our products to short. And you'll see the ASX index was at the top kind of next six. People, sometimes it's hard for traders, if you're looking to kind of trade the market, to pick single stocks. And a lot of people just pick the direction on the whole market. So the index is very popular. You'll see the NASDAQ is very popular. Now you'll see under investments, there's about four or five there. They're mostly banks. And that goes back to the strategy I spoke to you about. People, you know, using leverage to buy the banks, mainly because they have performed quite well over time, both on a capital side and on that dividend side. You know, if you're 50% geared, and CommBank is paying, say, a 5% yield, they're hoping to get that 8-9% dividend yield through their instalment structure.
And there was a whole bunch of questions actually coming through on Slido about protection, so I just waited to be able to answer that question. But definitely using a mini short, which is effectively giving you exposure to the share price falling, helps you hedge your underlying shares without actually having to physically sell them. So you can still earn dividends from that company. You can still earn not actually trigger capital gains tax events via using a mini short. Similarly, you can go and buy options from the options market, put options that will protect yourself against a fall in the marketplace itself. But if you are wanting protection for your shares, think the market's had a bit of a run, have a look, ASX website, Citi website, have a look at mini shorts and put options to help you protect some shares. Also, thinking about longer term loans. Someone's mentioned that margin loans useful for long term. They're talking 30 years here, which is a very, very long term margin loan. Most definitely, if you're very very confident about the future of that stock in over the long term. But definitely self-funding installments probably suit that really longer term investor, because it allows you to take the dividends that you're getting from that company to pay off your loan component. And over a long period of time, as long as your dividends are over the top of your loan, you can actually own the shares without having to make the second payment. So definitely some ways for longer term investors to use leverage as well. When it comes to the options market, similar to the way that the warrants market, you saw the top stocks, the S&P ASX 200 index, the number one stock that's being utilised in the options market, all for protection, really. Telstra, BHP, Fortescue, Commonwealth Bank, ANZ, Westpac, Rio, Newcrest and NAB are the other top 10 underlyings that we see. Almost matched exactly what you were talking about from a warrants perspective as well. It's our top stocks that we see in the market, or even the index itself, that people are utilising these strategies for. So we've heard that implementing leverage, you can do it via your broker the same way as you buy and sell shares. Importantly, you do have to sign an extra agreement form if you want to get involved in warrants or options out in the marketplace. We thought the best way to explain how minis work, which is some of the other questions here, and how an installment works, is really give you an understanding of some of the strikes that you look at in the market and how you'd select those. Before we get there, if you think a stock's going up, and you have to be very confident that a stock is going up when you're using leverage. Don't think or hope it's going to go up. We're trading risky products. If you think it's going up, you go long a mini, or you can go and buy calls from the options market. So that gives us leverage on the upside. If you are confident that we're going to have a sell-off, and I don't necessarily want protection, I actually want to make money as the market's falling, we can use a short mini or a bought put. So we're going to pick the long side of the equation just for ease of the room. And there is a group of trading and investment warrants with different strike prices giving us different levels of leverage. Can you walk through that? I think it will really become clear why you cannot lose more than what you outlay when we start looking at some of the terms on this table.
Yeah, so I've broken it. As I said, best thing to do is always to call us, because we do have many different types of products. But the top table is the trading product. You'll see that the leverage is typically higher, 84%, 79%, 74%. And the bottom table is more the investment style product. Now, an easy way to understand this is probably what Graham touched on with the Telstra installment receipt. When the government floated Telstra, they did it through the instalment process, buying Telstra in two payments, and they did that with CommBank as well, buying CommBank in two instalments. And this is what we're doing here. We're buying the first instalment now and paying the second instalment later. So buy now, pay later, that's kind of come back in fashion when you go shopping. Conceptually, it's got similarities. So let's use CommBank JOD, which is an investment style product. CommBank's $95. When you buy CommBank JOD, as I mentioned, that moment that you put your trade through your broker, we are buying that CommBank share. So you've put in to buy 100 CommBank JOD, we buy 100 CommBank shares, and we put that in the bear trust. You are buying it at the live market price of CommBank at $95. Now, for JOD, the one that you've selected the one where we lend you $65. So if CommBank shares are $95, we lend you $65 here, you would put the difference of $30. If CommBank, because you're the holder, you've got 100 CommBank shares in bear trust, if CommBank goes up $5, your instalment mini is going to go up $5. If it drops $10, your instalment mini will also drop $10. So cent for cent, dollar for dollar, it will move with the CommBank share price, less the interest costs you pay. The interest cost on this at the moment is 5.05% per annum. So if you hold it for the full year, that's the interest you pay. If you hold it for the 2-3 months over the dividend period, that's the interest you pay prorated. Now, you'll see that there's a stop loss in there. You know, there's a stop loss from 71.50 down to 49.50. You are using a leverage instrument. You should use the stop loss to help you manage your risk. So, for example, some people might think, I'm going to hold CommBank only for 2 weeks, and the stop loss at 71.50, I'm quite comfortable with. I don't think CommBank's going to fall to 71.50. That might be the instalment that suits you. For another investor, they go, oh, I want to set and forget this a little bit more. I don't, you know. So I'll probably pick the 49.50 because I don't think CommBank's going to fall to 49.50. So that might be the instalment that suits them. You've got to pick the gearing and the stop loss that suits you. Now, stop losses are not always good or bad. Sometimes they're good. In the case of A2M, which we've seen in the last 2 years just fall, the stop loss is also a way for you to try and manage your risk where it goes, if that stock actually falls to that price, I do want to sell out. Because when the stop loss is triggered, we take that 100 shares sitting in the bear trust, we sell it, we pay off the loan, and we pass back the difference to you. Now, where will you get nothing back? So let's say you've bought a mini for, let's say you've bought a stock, CBA, for $30. If CommBank were to fall by more than that $30, you can only lose up to that $30. So the time where you get nothing back is if there's a very big fall in the market, less likely for something like CommBank, but if there's a big fall and it falls by more than what you've put in, then just like holding the stock, if it falls by more than $10, you will lose whatever it falls. Here, it's capped to what you've put in.
Yep, great. And I think it's really important to understand that stop loss level. At some points in time, shares will get very close to that stop loss level. Unfortunately, when it is triggered, that is the end of the life of that particular mini. And then Citi go about obviously selling out of those shares at that particular point in time. So it could trigger the loss at that particular point in time. So just because you're getting super leverage out of something doesn't mean it's the best choice. Maybe pick a strike price a little bit further away from where the shares are trading to give you a little bit more protection on that trade. When I think about minis before we start looking at questions, on that previous slide, we do get questions around instalments versus minis. I think the key difference between a standard instalment and the mini is you've got this stop loss embedded within the mini itself, where a lot of instalments actually have expiry dates that go out into the future. You can go below those strike price levels for the stock to come back. So I think that's one of the key differences between your instalments and minis.
Yeah, so always, as I said, call us. Not all our products have a stop loss. Some products have no stop loss. So some people might prefer a stop loss. Some people prefer not to have a stop loss. It's a matter of working out what features are in the type of product that you potentially, it might suit you.
And you can access a whole bunch of markets. So we're not just talking those top 10 stocks in the options market, we're saying, and pretty much all of those top 20 warrant holdings. We can get exposures to commodities, to currencies, all through the same place that you access your shares via the ASX. And we got some of those listed up on the screen. If we could, up on the screen behind us, get some of those Slido questions up now, we can flick across to them. Use of margin loans or call options, we kind of touched on that. We can actually use margin loans, call options, or instalments to be able to access the market. They can all give us leverage. The difference, though, is that minis, instalments, and options, the most you can lose in what you outlay. You can actually lose more than what you outlay with margin loans.